Hello and a very warm welcome, especially to those of you joining us from the HIV or NA Test Guide podcast. We know you rely on us for trusted HIV testing info with access to over 4,500 labs nationwide.
That's right. And because you're tuned in to reliable HIV information, we thought we'd tackle something really quite significant today.
We're going to be talking about potential shifts in global HIV funding. Big topic. And what that could actually mean, especially for places like sub-Saharan Africa.
Exactly. We're going to try and unpack a recent study. It used mathematical modeling, but complex, but essentially using math to predict outcomes to explore what might happen if funding from PEPFAR was temporarily frozen.
PEPFAR being the President's Emergency Plan for AIDS Relief, a huge U.S. program.
Absolutely massive one. So our mission today really is to give you some clarity, some context on why this is relevant and frankly quite important for you to be aware of.
And just so you know where this is coming from, the source is a study published in a Clinical Medicine, a peer-reviewed journal. Okay, so maybe let's start with PEPFAR itself for anyone maybe less familiar.
Good idea. So PEPFAR, it's a U.S. government initiative, and honestly, it's been absolutely fundamental in the global fight against HIV.
Especially when it comes to getting treatment out there, right?
Right.
Antiretroviral therapy, RT.
Precisely. Particularly in sub-Saharan Africa, which has historically borne the, you know, the heaviest burden of the epidemic, PEPFAR really drove the scale-up of art there.
It's kind of mind-boggling when you look at the numbers. Back in the early 2000s, How many people in sub-Saharan Africa were getting art?
Practically none. It was almost zero.
And now? Fast forward to 2023.
The estimate is around 21 million people receiving treatment. It's just an astonishing scale up, truly transformative.
Any impact that's had? I mean, we're talking lives saved.
Oh, absolutely. The drop in HIV-AIDS related deaths in sub-Saharan Africa is, well, stark. It went from something like 2.2 million deaths back in 2003,
Black.
Down to around 390,000 in 2023. These are huge numbers, but it's crucial to remember, you know, each number is a person, a family.
A life not cut short. It makes any potential disruption feel, well, really serious.
It does. And there's another benefit too, right? ART doesn't just keep people healthy.
No, it also dramatically reduces the amount of virus in someone's system, which means they're much, much less likely to transmit HIV to others.
Exactly. Undetectable equals untransmittable, as the saying goes, and that's played a big part in reducing new infections too.
So those numbers also dropped.
Significantly, from about 3.2 million new infections in 2003 down to roughly 640,000 in 2023. So PEPFAR's impact has been multifaceted, life-saving and prevention.
Which brings us back to this study and why its findings are potentially so concerning.
Yeah.
You mentioned a funding freeze.
Yes. The study modeled a specific scenario based on an event. On January 24th, 2025, the U.S. government put a temporary 90-day freeze on all foreign aid programs.
And that included PEPFAR.
It did. Now, there was a limited waiver introduced in February.
Right, for sort of the most critical things, life-saving care, preventing mother-to-child transmission.
Exactly. But, and this is a really key point the study considered, getting that waiver didn't just instantly fix everything on the ground.
It's not like flipping a switch.
Not at all. Reports coming out of Africa suggested there were real delays, logistical hurdles in actually getting the waiver applied and implemented. So restarting treatment activities wasn't immediate in many, many places.
And the study noted that the freeze went beyond that initial 30-day mark without a clear end date in sight at the time they were modeling.
That's right. So this study set out to estimate, okay, what could the consequences of this kind of disruption actually be?
Using that mathematical modeling approach you mentioned.
Yes. They aimed to project the potential impact on both HIV deaths and new infections, looking specifically at the period between 2025 and 2030.
And they focused on certain countries?
They did. Seven key countries in sub-Saharan Africa: Ethiopia, Kenya, Malawi, South Africa, Tanzania, Zambia, and Zimbabwe.
Okay. And why those seven?
Well, together, those countries actually account for roughly half of all people living with HIV in sub-Saharan Africa. So a very significant chunk of the affected population.
Right. So the model, it wasn't just about funding stops, bad things happen. It was more nuanced.
Much more nuanced. The researchers specifically factored in time lags. You know, the effects of stopping treatment aren't instant, but they build up. And similarly, when treatment restarts, it takes time for the system to get back up to speed and for individuals' health to recover.
That makes sense. It reflects the reality of healthcare systems. So what were the different scenarios they looked at? You mentioned four.
Yes. The first they called executive order proportional. This basically assumed that the treatment disruptions in each country would be directly proportional to how much PEPFAR funding that country usually gets.
Kind of a baseline disruption scenario, maybe?
Yeah. Then they had one called Executive Order Realistic. And this one, it painted a tougher picture. It assumed a more severe breakdown, almost a near total collapse of the treatment systems heavily reliant on that funding.
Okay, that sounds grim. And the other two?
The other two scenarios factored in that waiver we talked about. They modeled what might happen if treatment could restart after, say, 4 weeks of disruption, or alternatively, after 8 weeks.
Right. So they tried to cover a range of possibilities. Let's get to the findings then. The excess deaths, obviously a major concern. What did the models show?
Okay, so under that first proportional scenario, the projection was for between 60,000 and 71,000 excess HIV deaths.
Just in those seven countries over 5 years.
Exactly. And just to be clear, excess deaths means deaths that wouldn't have happened otherwise, directly due to the funding disruption and treatment interruption. The model suggests that interrupting treatment leads to viral rebound pretty quickly.
Meaning the virus increases in the body again.
Right. Which makes people vulnerable to opportunistic infections. Their disease progresses faster, leading to death. And tragically, it also makes them more infectious again.
That's a huge number, 60 to 71,000.
It is. And remember, that was the less severe scenario in terms of system collapse.
So the realistic scenario must have been worse.
It was. The projection there was between 63,000 and 89,000 excess deaths in those seven countries alone.
89,000. Wow.
And the researchers really stressed this point. This is just for the countries they modeled, representing about half the HIV population in sub-Saharan Africa. The total number across the entire continent
would likely be substantially higher. Much higher.
Much higher, yes. Sobering stuff.
Okay, what about the scenarios where the waiver kicked in? Did that mitigate the impact significantly?
It did mitigate it, but the numbers were still really worrying. Even with treatment restarting after just 4 weeks, the 4-week waiver scenario, they projected between 15,000 and 28,000 excess deaths.
15 to 28,000 additional deaths, even with a relatively quick restart.
Yes. And if the restart took 8 weeks, the 8-week waiver scenario, the projection was between 22,000 and 36,000 excess deaths.
It just hammers home how vital that continuous uninterrupted treatment is. There's really no safe period to stop.
Absolutely not. Any disruption has consequences.
Now, the study also looked at new infections, didn't it? What did it find there?
It did. Focusing on those waiver scenarios, again, the 4-week and 8-week restarts, the models projected a potential increase of between 35,000 and 103,000 excess new HIV infections.
Wait, for both scenarios? 4 weeks and 8 weeks.
Interestingly, yes. The range was the same for both the 4-week and 8-week waiver scenarios in their model. 35,000 to 103,000 additional infections across those seven countries.
Why would that be the same range?
Well, the model likely suggests that once treatment is interrupted, even for 4 weeks, the increase in viral loads across the population might be enough to significantly raise transmission risk for a period. And perhaps restarting slightly later doesn't drastically alter that specific projection range for new infections within their model's parameters. It highlights that even short interruptions can fuel onward transmission.
So treatment disruption doesn't just harm the individual, it increases the risk for the whole community.
Precisely. It's a public health ripple effect.
Given these, frankly, alarming projections, I imagine the study authors had some strong conclusions.
They did. Unsurprisingly, they issued an urgent call. They pushed for the rapid and crucially full reinstatement of PEPFAR funding.
And they didn't mince words about the program itself.
No, they described PEPFAR as, and I'm quoting here, one of the most successful health programs in the history of public health. That's powerful language.
It really puts the stakes into perspective.
Mm.
Did they suggest anything else beyond just restoring the funding, thinking longer term?
Yes, they did. They pointed towards the need for global partnerships to really start thinking proactively, developing mitigation strategies. What happens if there's a partial or even a full withdrawal of U.S. support down the line?
Planning for resilience, essentially. What might those strategies look like?
Well, it could involve things like other high-income nations stepping up their contributions, exploring, you know, innovative financing ideas, or really focusing on strengthening the local healthcare systems within African nations so they become more self-sufficient over time.
Building that long-term sustainability.
Exactly. It's a critical piece of the puzzle.
And they also had a message about local data in action, right?
Yes. Very important. They emphasize the need for local research programs, implementation projects on the ground to actively track what's happening, collect data on treatment defaults, people stopping their meds, and monitor HIV deaths in the wake of any disruption.
Real-time information to guide the response.
Absolutely. And they also called for innovation within HIV programs themselves, finding new ways to deliver care, perhaps more efficiently, or ways to cope if long-term funding becomes tighter.
So using local knowledge and data to adapt.
That's the idea, making sure solutions are tailored and sustainable from the ground up.
So for you, our listeners, especially those connected through the HIVRNA Test Guide podcast, really focused on testing and care here in the U.S., you can see how these global dynamics are interconnected.
Definitely. What happens with a major global program like PEPFAR, even if it feels geographically distant, it really does impact the overall landscape of HIV prevention, treatment, and research globally. The progress is linked.
A setback in one area can have ripple effects everywhere.
It truly can. Which leads us to maybe a final thought, a question for you to ponder.
Considering just how profoundly effective consistent HIV treatment has proven to be, saving millions of lives.
What do you think are the most crucial steps we need to take right now to guarantee that access to HIV care and testing remains uninterrupted? Not just globally, but think about it within our own communities, our own healthcare systems right here in the U.S. too.
It's a complex challenge, isn't it? Requires effort at all levels. Something important to keep thinking about.